Yeah, in the last session of numerical methods, we discussed applying partial derivatives to evaluation which is performed using a Monte Carlo simulation. The first thing we discussed was the finite difference method. Of course, before we had a look at what happens for linear and discontinuous payoffs if we consider the, say, true solution, the analytic solution. And for the finite differences, actually the two approximation steps we have. So one is the finite difference approximation for the differential operator, and the other one is the Monte Carlo integral for the integral operator or the expectation operator. In some sense, they commute, yeah. So we can interpret it as a finite difference applied to the Monte Carlo approximation. So we have a pathwise finite difference here. Yeah. Or we can actually interpret it as first applying the finite difference, so what is here on the slide, and then each part is approximated with the Monte Carlo approximation. So the nice thing of this method is that we need very little information about our setup. Yeah. So once we can perform the evaluation, we can calculate this finite difference approximation. So that this no additional information was related to that we have a valuation algorithm, which can perform valuation for different parameters. So the only thing is that we need to shift the parameter. And we started implementing this. So here is the program we created in the previous session. So we have a model specified by the initial value risk-free rate volatility. We consider a European option specified by maturity and the strike. We perform a Monte Carlo simulation with an Euler scheme, discretization, time horizon dt, and number of passes. This function just creates the Monte Carlo simulation of that model. And then to check if everything is nice, we evaluated a European option here analytically and here using Monte Carlo, and we printed the result and compared the result. And our evaluation routine was quite short. Yeah? So it's here, and it was a little bit general as we could use any payoff function. So any European option with the payoff function of S of capital T can be valued here. So here we provide the payoff function belonging to the European option, S minus K, take the maximum of that and zero. Okay, and then we used a fairly general finite difference approximation to the delta. So that method is here, and you see it's also quite short. Just create a model with a shifted initial value. So we don't need much to know about the model, just it has to generate a copy with a shifted initial value. And then perform the evaluation on this upshifted model, perform the evaluation on the downshifted model, and calculate the finite difference. So we can run this program, and we see here our results. Yeah, so that was the finite difference approximation, and that was the evaluation. So first, to get a better understanding how the finite difference approximation depends on the shift size, I would like to create a plot of the finite difference approximation as a function of the shift size. So let's write here some method which creates us such a plot. So let's call it get plot delta approximation by shift. Yeah. So what do we need to provide to this model? Well, I like to plot different ranges of the shift. So maybe from 0 to 12, I would like to have these arguments to be the scale. So the shift size should be 10 to the minus scale. No? So 10 to the minus 0 is 1, 10 to the minus 12, and so on. Yeah? And yeah, so I can really see a very large range of the shifts. And then, of course, I need everything which we need here to calculate the finite difference approximation. So that is to have the model, the maturity, and actually the payoff function. So this should be my plot. So let's create such a function which creates such a plot here. So for a given payoff function, yeah, so this can be a general payoff function, let's create the plot that maps the scale of the shift size. So how should I call this plot? Let's call it finite different approximation as a function of the shift, and this should map the scale of the shift size to our finite difference approximation of that model with that maturity, that payoff function. Oops. And here as a shift size, I would like to have a scale. Let's take 10 to the minus scale as the shift size. Okay. And while this is an absolute shift in the finite difference approximation, so you know my initial value here is at 100. So maybe to have this be a little bit more model independent, let's take a relative shift. So this absolute shift is initial value multiplied with this. So if this is 1, I shift by the full initial value. So if it is 10 to the minus 2, yeah, I shift by 1 divided by 100 of the initial value. Okay, so now I would like to plot this function here. So this here should be the minimum of the x-axis, so which is our scale. This here should be the maximum of the x-axis. So let's create the plot, and I have a small helper which creates such plots. So create a plot of this function here. So let's have a look at this plot. So that can be done by plot.show. So let's plot this. So we see for very large shifts, so large shifts are here on the left, yeah, small scale parameter, we get error, a large error here, and then it looks quite stable. Let's plot different range, let's say from 2 to 12. Okay, so you see there's here some error, then it looks quite stable, and then there is some noise. So before I like to discuss this picture, let's maybe make the plot a little bit nicer. So I like to add a title. So what do we see here? So this is the finite difference approximation of the delta of a European option, and Maybe I also set the x-axis label. So on the x-axis, we have the scale. So the shift size is 10. So initial value as 0 times 10 to the minus scale. Okay, and the y-axis is just the value of our finite difference approximation. And maybe I also like to set the number format of the y-axis because I need a little bit more digits. So let's say 5 digits. Okay, so now we should have a nicer plot. So this is the finite difference approximation of the delta. Let's annotate this graph a little bit. So this noise here is coming from the floating point arithmetic. So the shift size is so small that we get rounding errors when we have the finite difference approximation. You saw this in a previous session on the finite difference approximation. Then we see that there is a relative large region here where the finite difference approximation is independent of the shift. And actually, if you zoom in here, you will see that it is really independent of the shift. It's always the same value. And why is that? So first, we already noted that the finite difference approximation of differentiate s of t with respect to s zero is exact. Yeah, so the reason was that s of t is just a linear function of s zero. It's s zero of exponential something. Yeah. So if you apply the finite difference of this linear function, then you get independent of the shift. As long as you don't have rounding errors in the floating point arithmetic, you get the exact value. So what's happening here? So to understand this, let's see what we are doing. So this here is the payoff of the European option. So there's K here. And now we perform a Monte Carlo simulation. So there are some points here. So for example, this one, that one. And now we perform a shift to the finite, to the initial value. So we get slightly shifted Monte Carlo sample points. And you see, since we just shift here the initial value, it's just a shifted realization. So the sample point which we then get is maybe the one here directly next to the previous point, shifted. And if you then perform the pathwise finite difference, you get the slope of the payoff function at this point. Yeah. So the other part which we have is f prime. And f prime is approximated by f at x plus h minus f at x minus h divided by 2h. So a pathwise finite difference. So here we get 0. So on this path here, it's 0. And here we get 1. So our pathwise finite difference, if we go back to this page, that was, so the pathwise finite difference here will differentiate f of y, in our case, the maximum function of s of t minus k and 0. And either we get 1 multiplied with the inner derivative, so multiplied with the finite difference applied to the s of t, or we get 0. And this we get for any shift size, yeah, because it doesn't matter if here this guy is a little bit closer together or not, as long as we don't cross this kink here. Yeah? So if we cross the kink from here to there, then the approximation suddenly starts depending on the shift size. And this is what is happening at this point here. So at this point, the shift size has become so large that in our pathwise finite difference, one value was on the left of k and the other was on the right of k. So the point where this happens, here it is 4.7 or something like this, or 4.75, of course depends on how many passes do you use. Okay, maybe we can just check this and then we continue. So I'm now claiming that this picture, the point where we have this effect here depends on the number of passes. So if we use more passes, so these are 10,000, let's use 100,000. How does the picture look if we use 100,000 passes? Okay, so now the picture looks like this. And you see it has flattened out. The point is still the same. It's more passes, so it happens earlier. Okay, so it's not so good to see. So, but it happens a little bit earlier. Let's take less passes. Okay, so let's take less passes. Maybe this is nice to see then. Let's take 1,000 passes. Okay, so and now you see it happened. This effect happened before at 4.7. Now it happens very lately. But with fewer passes, you have a Monte Carlo error in the sample of S. Yeah? And the derivative of here of S of t with respect to S0 is just S of t divided by S0. So taking the expectation, we still have the Monte Carlo error from this. So now we have maybe a good understanding what happens if we apply a finite difference to a European option payoff. So to conclude this discussion, so we had 100,000 passes or 10,000 passes? I don't know, 10,000, I believe. So now let's go back to our program and maybe investigate another financial product, so another payoff function. Let's try to have a look at the digital option. So what we pay here is the indicator function of S minus K. Okay, so I will also do a plot, but maybe let's disable the plot for a while. Yeah, we will do this later. And I just want to have now a finite difference approximation for the digital option. So first let's calculate the analytic value. So value delta digital analytic. So there is an analytic formula somewhere, so we can use that. So this is the Black-Scholes digital option delta for the initial value, the risk free rate, the volatility, and the maturity, and the strike. Okay, so now we calculate the value of the digital using finite differences. So and now I can just use my get delta finite difference method for my model, my maturity, and here as payoff function, I use the payoff function for the digital option. And as a shift, maybe let's also use 10 to the minus 3. Okay, and then I use my print function, which prints the result. So this is the finite difference approximation. I compare the finite difference approximation of the digital by the analytic value. So to distinguish this, let's print some headlines. So this here is now the digital option which we investigate. Okay, and print here, that is the European option. Okay, so let's now check what is the finite difference approximation applied to this payoff function here, which is the digital one. Okay, and you see what we get is 0. Okay, so we have a very large error because the true analytic solution is 0.00443. So I get a completely unreasonable result. Okay, so maybe that's due to the shift size. Let's take a larger shift size, 10 to the minus 1. Yeah, so 0.1 times the initial value. So that would be a shift of 10. Okay, and we get a value which is, you know, which is reasonable. But we have to use a very large shift size. The shift size which we use, which if we use it here, would create some error. So that's strange. So to investigate this, how does the digital now depend on the shift size? Let's also create a plot. So creating a plot is now easy for us. Yeah? So I just copy this code here. And we change the payoff function. So the payoff function which we like to differentiate now is the one of the digital option. And of course, I should also change the title. So this is the digital option. And that's now the plot for the digital option. So that here was the plot for the European option. So So I have all the namings correct. And let's show the plot for the digital option. So this is now the dependence of the finite difference approximation of the delta of the digital option on the shift size, so the scale of the shift size. So this here are small shifts, 10 to the minus 10, 10 to the minus 7, here a large shift. And we see that something is happening at the point 4.75, 4.8. Okay, that's a familiar location here. So that was actually the point to the left, the finite difference approximation of the European option was becoming poor. But here it is that to the left, actually the finite difference becomes, say, it's decent, but to the right it's completely wrong. So maybe if I change here the interval from 2 to 8, yeah, because the small shifts are now obviously not of interest to us, then we get this picture. So let's annotate this a little bit. What is happening here? So the situation is very similar to the finite difference applied to the payoff of the forward, but now my payoff function looks like this. So this here is the value k, and I have an indicator function. So I pay you 1 if I'm above pay, I pay you 0 if I'm below pay, k. And now I perform a Monte Carlo valuation of this payoff. So we sample points. Some points are here, here, and here. And if we now apply a pathwise finite difference, the point evaluated with the shifted model is next to the previous point, and the finite difference approximation is 0. Yeah? So what we get here is that f of x plus h minus f of x minus h. So I just write it like x plus h, x minus h divided by 2h. Yeah? So this is always 0. Yeah? So we get a 0 here, a 0 here, and a 0 here. Okay, so this is what is happening in this region. Yeah, and if you make the shift smaller, that persists. And you already know that this point here is the point where a Monte Carlo pass is crossing the K. Yeah. So the downshifted or upshifted one is on the left-hand side of K, and the upshifted or downshifted one, yeah, so the other one is on the right-hand side of K. Yeah. So that's the picture like that. And what we get here is that the slope is 1 divided by 2h. So the slope here is 1 divided by 2h. So that was what we calculated analytically, that we now sample a Bernoulli experiment where very often we have the value 0, and very rarely we have the value 1 divided by 2h, which is a large value. Yeah? So you see here, this is here the jump. And this jump size is actually 1 divided by 2h. So divided by the number of passes. Yeah? So on one pass, we jump. Okay, so that's what is happening here. So, and now you see that this form we have here is just 1 divided by h for h becoming larger. Yeah. So this is like 1 divided by h for h becoming larger. So h is becoming larger to the left. And then this is the point here where the next pass is crossing k. Okay, so and you see you have to take very large shift size to maybe have a decent approximation, but if you take very large shift size, then we have the problem that the finite difference is no longer a good approximation, yeah, because we get from the Taylor expansion the remainder term. Okay, so now we have some understanding how finite differences work. So let's go back to our program. So I just disable the plot because I like to now print more result. So here I have the European option, the digital option, and we only looked at finite differences. Let's do the following. From the European to the digital option, we have become less regular, less smooth. Yeah? So the European option is at one point not differentiable, but it is continuous. The digital option is discontinuous. So we also have here the payoff function, which is the forward. Maybe let's also plot this one. So I would like to see what happens if I apply the finite difference approximation to the forward. So this is just the forward. So the analytic solution of the delta is, okay, differentiate the value of the forward. If I pay s of t in capital T, today's value is s0, differentiate that with respect to s0 is 1. Yeah? So actually I know the analytic solution, it is 1. So what happens, so that is the forward. What happens if I perform now the finite difference approximation of this? So let's call it value delta forward finite difference. And I use our function, which calculates finite differences for arbitrary payoff function. So let's plug this in here and let's print the result of this experiment by comparing, the analytic to the finite difference. Okay, that's the forward. Let's add for completeness one other financial product. That is the financial product which pays. So this here is a linear function. So let's also have the financial product which pays a constant. Let's pay a unit 1. So this is new scalar 1.0. So I pay a unit 1. This is a zero bond. Yeah? So let's call this a zero bond or bond here. So this, of course, does not depend on the initial value of the stock. So the analytic value for this bond delta is 0. So if you differentiate this with respect to the initial value of the stock, it doesn't depend on the initial value of the stock, you get 0. So I look like to plot the finite difference approximation of that guy. And let's compare here the analytic solution, which we expect to the bond a finite difference approximation of the delta. So also maybe I correct the typo. Okay, So now we have a quite nice list of financial products, a constant, a linear function, the maximum of S minus K, yeah, so continuous but not linear with a kink, and a discontinuous function. And we can plot now all these finite difference approximations. Okay, so, and what you see is that we have very poor result for the digital option. We get a decent result for the European option. There is still an error for the linear function here. Why is that? And of course, there's no error in the finite difference because finite difference of a zero, of a constant, constant minus constant divided by 2h is zero. So this is exact even if you just have a single Monte Carlo pass. Okay, so now here in our little program, I like to say use different approximation methods like that one for all these four different financial products. So maybe it makes sense to move here the approximation method to a separate function. So let's call this function here check delta approximation methods. So I would like to check this for a given model and a given payoff at a given maturity. Oops. And I would like to compare that with a given analytic value. So now I can move these two lines here to say this new method here, which performs this investigation. And okay, this here is the delta finite difference for an arbitrary payoff function. Yeah. And one thing which I would like to maybe do is I would like to print two different finite difference approximations, say one with 10 to the minus one. So this here is the finite difference where the shift is 10 to the minus one. Okay, let's call this finite difference one. And then here, this is the finite difference approximation where the shift is 10 to the minus 3. So now I can run the program and you see I have here for the European option already two different results. Okay, so maybe I make the printout a little bit nicer if I need more space here. Let's have a little bit more space for the output, also maybe more digits. And let's add this function, which now checks here the approximation method. Let's add this function to all our four products. Yeah, so here I look at the digital payoff function, comparing it with the digital value. Then here I use the linear payoff function, that of a forward, compare it to a value of the forward delta, so comparing to one. And here for the zero coupon bond, I use the bond payoff function and compare to the analytic value. So since the bond does not depend on the initial value of S, analytic value, analytic delta is zero. So, and we get this output now for our four products. So what do we see? So for the digital option, it makes a big difference if we choose the shift 10 to the minus 1 or 10 to the minus 3. So already 10 to the minus 3, which is a comparably large shift, will give us a bad result. For the European option, it's actually vice versa. The shift 10 to the minus 1 is too large. Yeah, the error becomes bigger. 10 to the minus 3 is maybe okay. For the forward, it is a linear function. The shift doesn't matter. But we have an error here. And for the bond, the shift doesn't matter, and we get the exact result. Okay, so why do we get the exact result? Because we are calculating the expectation of zero, and expectation of zero is, even with a single Monte Carlo pass, it is correct. So the error which we see here for the forward is that if we go back to the slide, we know that the finite difference approximation of differentiating S with respect to x0 is exact, but the result, so we get the exact result, which is S of t divided by S0, this is still a random variable, and taking the Monte Carlo approximation has a Monte Carlo error. So what you see here is the Monte Carlo error of S of t divided by S of zero. Okay, so now I have this nice function here, which checks the delta approximation, and I would like to add more methods to this function. The next method I like to discuss is the pathwise differentiation. Okay, what is the pathwise differentiation? So in the pathwise differentiation, I apply the differential operator to the expectation, taking here the expectation as an integral over the probability measure. I assume that I can interchange integration and differentiation. Okay. Then this means I differentiate just f of y with respect to theta. So furthermore, I assume that I can express this as f prime, so differentiate f, times the inner derivative. And now you see that the expectation operator here, the expectation operator is an integral over my measure dq. So you just rediscover this here, integral over your measure dq. So you see that this is just the expectation of this function here, f prime times dy by d theta. Okay, so I just perform pathwise differentiation of the stochastic, so of the random variable of f of y theta. And after I have done that, now I perform the Monte Carlo approximation. So now we perform the Monte Carlo approximation. So Monte Carlo approximation step is here. And we get to this expression here. So you see, this is like valuation. We value we take the expectation of this function, so we value somehow a different payoff. So what I need is the differential of f and the differential of y. So we have a few bad requirements here. So we need additional information of the stochastic process. Yeah? So we need to know what is dy by d theta. Yeah? So dy by d theta is different for Black-Scholes model or for the Bachelier model, Heston, or whatever. Actually, we don't need to know how the numerical scheme is generated. But we need to know something about the function f, yeah, because we need f prime. For the finite difference, I didn't need to know anything. of the function f, I just have to evaluate it. So which I need for the valuation anyway. And we also need to know what is theta, because in order to calculate dy by d theta, I need to know what is theta. So we have a few properties. So there's an unbiased derivative, because we perform the derivative analytically. Actually, it looks like discontinuous payoff cannot be handled, because you can get otherwise a Dirac distribution here, a Dirac delta. But it is possible to handle this case by separating the jumps. So before I do this, let's have a look at an example. So to summarize, the major disadvantage is that the method requires special knowledge about the function f and special knowledge about the model used here. So about dy by d theta. So for a Black-Scholes model, I already noted this several times, the dy by d theta. So here, this is an example. The y is just a European option, and this is just s of t in my Black-Scholes model, and the theta is just s zero. And since we know that s of t is s zero times exponential of rt minus 1/2 sigma squared t plus sigma w of t, I know that ds of t, so dy by d theta, in my example, is just this exponential function, which is s of t divided by s zero. Okay, so we have this nice result. So in order to apply the pathwise method in a Black-Scholes model setup, we have to differentiate our payoff function and multiply it with a weight with s of t divided by s zero. And from that, we take the Monte Carlo expectation. So we perform just evaluation. So actually, this is quite nice. So what we have here is the value of the delta using the pathwise method. I like to have a new method here that calculates for our given model the given maturity. And now I need the derivative of the payoff function. So the payoff function derivative, that should be used in the calculation of the pathwise delta. So actually here I need another argument. I don't need the payoff function, I need the derivative of the payoff function. So we will supply this in a few seconds to this function. So let's just finish here the implementation of the pathwise method. So given that we have the derivative of the payoff function, so we ask our model for the underlying. At maturity. Okay, and instead of now defining the payoff, we define the derivative of the payoff. So this is the payoff derivative function. So the payoff function derivative applied to the underlying. Okay, then we need to multiply this by the weight. So on the slides, by the weight here, s of t divided by s zero. So this is underlying divided by initial value. So this is the total derivative of the payoff. Okay. And then we divide by the numerator and get the value of the delta. So we divide by the numerator. At maturity, we multiply with the numerator. At evaluation time, and return the expectation of this. Okay, so that should be our pathwise delta. So let's add a print here. So let's compare the pathwise to the analytic value, and let's write here pathwise method. Okay, so my program still has errors because now my check delta function requires that we pass the derivative of the payoff function as another argument. So if the payoff function is a constant, then the derivative of this constant is actually zero. So I need here another function. So this is just zero. Okay, so the payoff, so the derivative of the payoff function of the bond is just the function that is always zero. The derivative of the payoff function, which is a linear function, is just one. So that is just my bond function. The derivative of the payoff function, which is an option, is actually the digital, so zero and then slope one. So this is the digital derivative of the European option, is the digital payoff. And for the digital payoff, okay, well, there is now a Dirac distribution. If I differentiate this discontinuity, so maybe I just have another dummy payoff function, which gives us not a number because I'm not able to calculate this, at least here in this setup. Yeah, so there are ways of evaluating this. Yeah? For example, if you know the density. Okay, so now let's run this program. So we will check for the four different products. Now also the pathwise method. Okay, so you see the pathwise method is not available here for our digital option. Okay, but for all the other options, we get some results. And you see that pathwise differentiation is actually the same as finite difference approximation with a small shift size for this product here, because the payoff function, as long as we do not cross the kink K, does not depend on the shift size. Okay, and we also replicate the same result for the linear and the constant function. So you see pathwise method works. Yeah, it's actually say maybe the best you can do with the finite difference approximation, but as you see here, you have to actually know some stuff from the model. Yeah, so this this weight here is model dependent. It's possible to do the pathwise method for discontinuous payoff. I just want to remark this. If you can separate the jumps, if you can separate the discontinuities, then actually you know that the expectation of the discontinuity is the jump size times the density at this point. So if you like to do this, you need, in addition to know the density, then you could also write it for a discontinuous payoff. Okay, so now for another method, and this is maybe a bit interesting. It's a little bit dual. It's the likelihood ratio. You saw for the finite difference and also for the pathwise method, it was good if the payoff was smooth. The smoother the payoff was, the better was the approximation. And in the end, we had no approximation error. The only error was the Monte Carlo error of the underlying model quantities. With the likelihood ratio method, it's exactly the opposite. So a smooth payoff has maybe an issue, has a larger Monte Carlo error. A discontinuous payoff can be handled quite well. It also has a Monte Carlo error, but it can be handled. So what's the idea here for the likelihood ratio method? So I assume that we know the probability density of our random variable y theta. If y depends on theta, of course, the probability density of y theta will depend on the parameter theta. Yeah? So if it is the initial value, yeah, then and you have a normal distribution, then it is e to the minus x minus mu squared. Yeah? Then the initial value will maybe somehow enter into this mu, yeah? The shift of the mean. Okay, so I assume that I know the density, then I can express here the expectation operator as an integral over phi dy. Yeah, so I can express the probability measure dq as phi dy on the state space, yeah, and on the space of values y. Okay, and now I do a little trick. So if I now like to differentiate the expectation operator, you see that the only thing that depends on theta is now here the density. So f does not depend on theta. So that could be maybe an assumption, yeah? So I only differentiate a model parameter. And then the model F is evaluated on the model. Okay, so if I now move the differentiation inside the integral, so I assume that I can flip integration and differentiation. The differentiation applies only to the density. So we get here d by d theta of the density. Okay, so I have differentiated the density and I do a little trick. I add another density here. So these two cancel. Yeah. So I divide by the density and multiply by the density again. So why I do this? Because then you discover that here you have just an expectation. This is an integral over phi dy. Okay, so you have an expectation operator again, and you have an expectation operator of a modified payoff. And the modified payoff is now F times W, where this W is this expression. It's the differentiate the density divided by the density. So the divide by the density pops in because I like to have a density again to have an expectation. So differential of the density divided by the density is actually the differentiation of the logarithm of the density. Yeah. So this weight here, this weight here is actually d by d theta of the logarithm of the density. Okay, and then I plug in the y theta. So this is an interesting result because it means I don't have to differentiate f here. Yeah, so I can just use the payoff function as it is and multiply with a weight. So you see for the pathwise method, we had to differentiate f and also multiply with some kind of weight, which was the inner derivative, which was just chain rule. And here, interesting, it's just f times w. So these are the nice properties of this method. So you see, the good thing is that this need to know something about f is gone. Yeah. So compared to the pathwise method, I don't have to know f prime. Of course, I do have to know here the SDE, and I have to know the theta, yeah, because we have to calculate d phi by d theta. And that's maybe the biggest disadvantage. Yeah, you do not know the density in many cases. But actually, there is a trick that you can calculate the density numerically. But in this analytic form, this is a strong assumption. Yeah? So maybe summarize this here. So the good thing is that we don't need anything about the payoff function. Yeah, this is an advantage compared to the pathwise method, but we require the knowledge about the density. Yeah, so it requires that the density is known. And this is really the case. So let's check this for our computer program, so for the delta of a European option. So what's the density of S of T? So what's the probability density of So I need the probability density of S. Okay. Can we maybe shortly calculate this? Yeah. So if I have the probability density of S of T, so which is stated here, then what I need is I need to calculate here this weight. Differentiate the probability density of S of T with respect to S zero and divide by phi. So maybe I like to do that with you together. Let's see, what have we to do? Okay, maybe we do it very quickly. Okay, so S of T is log normal. So I know that S of T is S zero times exponential something. Yeah. So actually, I know that then a variable x, which is, say, some a times logarithm of s minus b is standard normal. Okay, so if I take the logarithm here, okay, then the b is logarithm of S0 plus RT minus 1/2 sigma squared T. That's the B. And actually the A is, well, there is here the sigma delta W. So the A is just sigma delta T. So that is the variance or the standard deviation of log S. So I have to divide by this to get here a standard normal X. Yeah? So X should be standard normal. Okay, so I know the probability density of X, but I do not know the probability density of S. Yeah? But if you have the probability density of X, then you know that phi of X is phi of X of S times dx by ds times ds, oh sorry, ds. So this expression here is our probability density phi s of s. Okay, so now we know the probability density of s. So, but from this probability density, actually, I like to know the differentiation. Yeah? So I like to know d by ds 0 of phi s. Okay, so you see, if I now differentiate this guy here with respect to s 0, so first this dx by ds here, dx by ds, if I differentiate this is just a divided by s, and you see the a does not depend on s0, so the only thing that depends on s0 is the b, so this guy here is just a constant, it does not depend on s0. So if we differentiate now this part here, our density, then this is the density of the standard normal differentiated multiplied with differentiate x with respect to s0. Okay, multiplied with a constant, which is dx by ds. So now another side note. The density of the standard normal is just a constant times exponential minus x squared 1/2. If you differentiate this, then you see this is just phi times, and then you get in a derivative a minus x, phi times a minus x. So from that, we get that ds by s0 phi s divided by phi s. So if we divide by phi s, so you see this is here is my phi s. If I divide by phi s, then this guy here, oops. If I divide by phi s, then this guy here and this guy here is vanishing, and the only thing that is left is x times dx by ds 0. Okay, so why is the minus one gone? No, it's not gone. So So what's now d x by ds zero? So I have to differentiate this x here with respect to the initial value, which is here, the s zero. So you see, this is just 1 divided by s zero. Okay, but there's a minus here. Okay. And actually, there is a bracket here around this. Sorry. Okay, so we get from that a plus x times a divided by s zero. Okay, so that's here our likelihood ratio. So that's here our likelihood ratio, which we need. This is the weight which we need for the Black-Scholes model. X divided by S zero divided by sigma square root of t. So let's implement the likelihood ratio method. Before I go to this, let's have another look here at this expression. So you see the likelihood ratio method. Now we know the likelihood ratio is just a weighted valuation of the normal payoff. So we can reuse just the payoff code and we can use just the valuation code and just modify the payoff with the weight. So let's try and implement this. So here I like to have a new test. So a value of the delta using the likelihood ratio method. So let's have some function get delta likelihood ratio. For a given model, I have a payoff at a given maturity. The payoff is the normal payoff function, which we need for this. And once I have this, let's print the result when we compare this value to the analytic value. So this is here the likelihood ratio method. So he asked me to implement this method. And the likelihood ratio method is very model dependent because I need to know the density and from that the derivative of the density of the model. So we actually need to know that we have a Black-Scholes model at work here. And for that reason, I do a cast. So you already see from this cast that from the implementation side, this is maybe not the nicest method, yeah, because it makes big assumptions. So I take from this Monte Carlo simulation the underlying model and I cast it to the Black-Scholes model because I need some information. And what information do I need? I need the parameter R, the risk-free rate from the model. I need the parameter sigma, the volatility from the model. I need, so this is sigma, I need the maturity which we had. Okay, that is just a product parameter. I need at t the s of t. So s of t is from the model the value of s at time t, okay, at maturity. And from these quantities, under the assumption that it is a Black-Scholes model, so what is ensured here by my cast, I can now calculate the likelihood ratio. So s of t is log normal distributed. I would like to have the random variable, the underlying normal distributed, standard normal distributed random variable. So I would like to have the w of t, which is the pound in increment, pound in motion, divided by a square root of t. So that is s of t is log normal. S of t is s of zero times the exponential. If I divide by the initial value, this is just the exponential of drift plus diffusion. If I take the logarithm, then this part here is r times t minus 1/2 sigma squared t plus sigma w of t. So I subtract from this the risk-free rate part multiplied with t. Okay, and I add to this the sigma squared times t, 1/2 sigma squared times t, so multiplied with 1/2 t. So this is now the sigma w of t, so I divide by the sigma, and I divide by the square root of t, and then this is my random variable x. Okay, so this is the random variable x here in this formula. So I still have to divide by S0 and multiply with a, but a is divided by sigma square root of t. So the likelihood ratio should be x divided by the initial value divided by square root of t. So that's my likelihood ratio. So once we have now the likelihood ratio, I can create this weighted payoff function. So my weighted payoff function is now payoff likelihood ratio weighted. This is a function which maps the underlying to the normal payoff function applied to the underlying multiplied with the likelihood ratio. And if I now value this weighted payoff, this is claimed to be the delta. So I have a function that performs a valuation, and now I perform a valuation not of my payoff function, but of the likelihood ratio weighted payoff function. So let's check what we get now here with the likelihood ratio method. So I run my program, and here is the result. Okay, so if we now look at the digital option, the likelihood ratio method performs very well. Okay, so it can cope with the discontinuity. Yeah. So the error is 10 to the minus 6, while the finite difference has a 10 to the minus 3 and 10 to the minus 4. So this is a factor 100 better for the discontinuous function. However, we observed that for all the others, for the continuous cases, the likelihood ratio method is always worse. Yeah, so it doesn't perform so well if the payoff is smooth. And there's another observation. If, for example, here for our bond, where the payoff is a constant, and differentiating the constant with a finite difference gives us exactly zero, yeah, constant minus constant divided by h is zero, the likelihood ratio method has an error. Yeah, it is here a small error, but it has an error. Okay, so where does this error come from? So if we go back here, you see that if the payoff function is just a constant, then I take here the expectation, so I take here the integral, the Monte Carlo integral, of a constant times the likelihood ratio weight. The expectation of the likelihood ratio weight is zero. You also see this here, this is just a standard normal random variable. The expectation of x is zero, but x is a random variable, so this guy here, yeah, is still a random variable. Okay, so it has a Monte Carlo error. So what you see here is the Monte Carlo error of the likelihood ratio. And that's the reason why the likelihood ratio method is not so good for smooth payoff, because it will add noise coming from the Monte Carlo error of this weight. Okay, so that was the likelihood ratio method, and we have some nice results here. So let's summarize a little bit our results. So I like to annotate this table here. So if you compare here the pathwise method and the finite difference approximation for the European option, then we get here actually the same result. So why? Because the payoff and the underlying is piecewise linear or linear in the parameter. Yeah? So pathwise, so we have a piecewise linear payoff. The underlying is linear. And H is so small that we do not cross the kink of the piecewise linear function. So here we have that these two differ because the shift has become so large that we cross the kink in the option payoff. So such that for at least one omega, we cross the strike. Okay. For the linear payoff, all the three methods give us actually the same value, yeah, because then we are truly linear. And the only thing that can happen is that the shift is far too small, so we get instabilities from floating point arithmetic. The likelihood ratio method performs very well for the discontinuous payoff. So likelihood ratio can handle discontinuous payoffs. But the likelihood ratio method does not perform well if the payoff is smooth. Especially note that the likelihood ratio adds some noise, adds some Monte Carlo error for even here the constant payoff. So likelihood ratio method adds a Monte Carlo error. And the pathwise method is of course not available if we have a discontinuity, at least not in our setup. What you could do is if you know the density, you can separate the Dirac deltas from this valuation. Okay, so that was a small summary on three different methods to calculate partial derivatives of Monte Carlo valuations. I like to finish by some more remarks. You can generalize the likelihood ratio method, and this is then leading to the so-called Malliavin calculus. So what we have there is that, like for the likelihood ratio method, we can express the differentiation of the expectation as an expectation of the payoff function with a given weight. So in our case here, it was the likelihood ratio weight. So the properties of this method are similar. So you need some information about the S2E to get these weights. And actually, it was shown that under certain condition, actually the likelihood ratio method corresponds to the Malliavin weight with the minimal variance. So that just as a remark on the likelihood ratio method. A last method, which I would shortly discuss, is the proxy simulation scheme. So when you think about the finite differences or the pathwise differentiation, we have a Monte Carlo simulation that generates values from a model. And when we modify a model parameter, we generate different values. Well, but that was maybe just an implementation side, because if you think of weighted Monte Carlo, actually we have a choice. Do we generate different values, or do we generate different probability weights? And the second approach is just what the likelihood ratio does. It keeps the same values, but generates different probabilities weights. So what the proxy simulation scheme does is we design a Monte Carlo valuation engine that actually also simulates the probability density of two different numerical schemes. One scheme is kept fixed, and the other scheme changes whenever the initial value changes. So actually, if we then apply a finite difference to this implementation, we will get a finite difference approximation of the likelihood ratio or the Malliavin weight. So it combines a little bit the simplicity of finite differences with the robustness of the likelihood ratio method. There is a full chapter on this, but I would like to shortly comment here. So you know that if you approximate the derivative with a finite difference, it looks as if you evaluate your financial product at two different values. So you have y at theta plus h and y at theta minus h. But if you know a density, actually you can express the two expectations with two different densities, namely the density at y of theta plus h and the density of y at theta minus h. And you have the same value under the integral. So now assume that your simulation scheme that generates the values is a different one. Let's call this here y naught or y circle. Okay, so this means that what we do here is a Monte Carlo approximation where one numerical scheme is generating the values and the other numerical scheme is generating this weight here. Which actually corresponds to the density of the shifted scheme divided by the density of the original scheme. So you see the weight is 1 if the two schemes are the same, and the weight is different if the schemes, the numerical schemes, change. So if now in your implementation the initial value has changed, but a change in the initial value will not change the values generated, it will change the probability weights generated, then you actually see that this is just a finite difference of the likelihood ratio. So this here is just the finite difference of the likelihood ratio. So this here is just the finite difference of the likelihood ratio. So what do we need to implement this? We need a numerical scheme that generates values and Monte Carlo weights. So actually just a numerical scheme that allows weighted Monte Carlo. And we need a choice whether a change in the initial value changes the values and keeps the weights, or changes the weights, the probability weights, according to the change in the densities and keeps the values. So that was a small remark on the proxy simulation scheme. So you see here on my list of requirements, we require additional information on the numerical scheme. And actually you can implement this in a very general setup so that it's actually independent of the model used to generate the two schemes. For this, maybe one remark. If you have a model, you know, with a very complex structure and then do an Euler scheme, each Euler step is very simple and the density of the Euler step is known. So it's often much easier to calculate the density of the numerical scheme than the density of the realizations of the SDEs. So this is here truly an advantage that we perform this density calculation on the discretized scheme and not on the SDE. So that was it. Yeah, the numerical experiments and code session. We have already conducted them. So I have some references here, which you can have a look at. And that was also it for today. Thanks.